Hello and welcome to another World War II podcast. This episode is released just after the 75th anniversary of the escape of 10 American prisoners of war and 2 Filipino convicts from the Davao Penal Colony. The following year, when the story broke, the US War Department would call it the greatest story of the war. The man made famous at the time for escaping and recounting the story was Lieutenant Colonel William Edwin Dyess, a fighter pilot who not only fought in the air but in the defence of Bataan led an amphibious assault as an infantryman. His story is now largely forgotten, eclipsed by other events in the war. But joining me to tell the story of Ed Dyess is John Lucas, who is fighting to get Dyess awarded the Medal of Honour and is keeping his memory alive. But just before we get to the war in the Pacific, I'd like to say hello to all the new patrons who supported the show in March. I had a great month and it's nice to see so many helping me put the show together. You can find out more about becoming a patron at patreon.com/WW2podcast. Once a patron of the show, you'll get your own custom RSS link, which you could put into your podcast software of choice, and all the little extras that I do will automatically download when they are released. Alternatively, if you sign up at www2podcast.com/donate, I'll put you on the mailing list and I'll send you a link to all the exclusive material as it is released. So, let's get cracking. John.
So, I mean, our starting point has to be, you know, William Ed Dyess. Where does he come from? What's his background pre-military?
His story starts not unlike, you know, a lot of the other American foot soldiers or, you know, the British Tommies, you know, or, you know, even the, you know, the regular Russian peasants that come out, you know, small town in Texas called Albany. It's located out in West Texas. There's more prickly pear cactus, you know, and mesquite trees than there are people in this area. He's one of those guys that sort of straddles an era. You know, he's growing up in a town where there are people who still remember having, you know, met or when Billy the Kid or other famous Western names came through their town, you know, on a stagecoach or a train or something. But yet he's also growing up in the era of flight. And when he's, 11 years old, he makes his father drive him to nearby Abilene, which is about 20 miles away because Charles Lindbergh was on his big national tour after his famous flight across the Atlantic. And so he wants to get a glimpse of Lindbergh, his big hero. He's fascinated with flight. And so the story kind of starts there. He has that typical, frontier Western upbringing, and he yearns for something more. And, you know, obviously that's looking up at the clouds in the sky.
It can't have been a too poor a background because he does go to law school, but he could already fly before he joins the military. Is that right?
There's a recurring theme in Dyess's life is he's one of those guys who figures out a way. He knows what he wants to do and he figures out how to do it. And I think that, you know, he fell in love with flight at such an early age. And, you know, he worked part-time jobs when he was going to school, high school, between high school and college there were a lot of barnstorming pilots that would flying around, you know, the Midwest and the West. They'd land in a town, they'd offer to take you up for a couple dollars. And, you know, so he kind of got hooked that way. And sooner or later, he's asking these guys if they'll give him a few lessons. And so he's pretty well acquainted with the cockpit and, you know, with the stick once he gets through school.
So it shows a sort of a level of determination. Plus it also, which is something I think, well, I struggle to try and picture is looking at the magic of flight where you've never seen it and suddenly you can see something in the air and think, I want to have a go at that. And you save up all your pennies to fly in a plane. Incredible. Yet he has his determination to do it before he joins the army. What makes him join the Air Force? I mean, did he join the army to join the Air Force specifically? Or did he go in and then join the Air Force? Presumably he wanted to fly in the army.
Typical with Dyess and with a lot of other, you know, pilots of that era, there was a Civil Air Patrol. There were a few other options, but it wasn't like a situation where, hey, you're going to be an airline pilot or something to aspire to. You know, there's only a few ways you can go about doing it back in this era. And for the most part, the military had the, you know, had the monopoly in terms of flying and, you know, the aviation industry. And that's where a lot of these guys went to sort of scratch that itch. They knew they wanted to fly. So you had to join up and put on a uniform in order to have access to these aircraft, and especially access to, you know, the most technologically advanced aircraft that were available.
How does he get on? I mean, he'd been in the Reserve Officer Training Corps, so presumably he knows what he's getting himself into. How does he get on in the military?
There were a lot of fateful occurrences in this man's life. He was heading down to Austin, Texas. He was going to enroll in law school at the University of Texas, and he was hitchhiking and happened to thumb a ride with a guy who washed out from the Army Air Corps training program, which was at the time based in San Antonio, Randolph and Kelly Fields. And those were before there was a U.S. Air Force Academy. It was called the West Point of the Air, and it was based in San Antonio. And as soon as he heard this man talk about what the training program was like, and I think he was just infatuated with the idea and decided that he'd be better equipped to serve in a cockpit instead of a courtroom. And he literally did a U-turn in terms of his life's plans and goals, and decided he was gonna go after being a pilot. He was gonna get his wings one way or the other.
He gets them pretty easily. He becomes one of the youngest squadron commanders.
He breezed through his training and came out with some of the highest marks, and was placed in a very high regard by his senior officers. And obviously he had a magical aura about him. He was the guy that his best friend, Sam Gracio, who ended up being his wingman and who escaped with him, just said that he was the leader, and you felt that in your bones. You knew it. And he said that his men, whether they were, fellow pilots, officers, or the enlisted men, they felt that, and they would follow him anywhere. They revered him. So he just had that natural, that innate, born-in leadership skills and training. And I think that, obviously his skill as a pilot was unmatched. And you combine that with his personality, his charisma, and his ability to motivate people, it just made him a natural leader. And the United States Army Air Corps didn't do a lot of smart things in the early part of World War II, but one of them was putting Ed Dyess in command of the 21st Pursuit Squadron, which is one of the first to be deployed overseas.
That's the Philippines he's deployed firstly, isn't he? And they avoid, it's Clark Field, the debacle, where everything's shot up on the ground, isn't it, on the first day of when the Japanese attack?
Right, yeah. He was, he left in November, early November 1941. He arrived in Manila on Thanksgiving Day. He basically had under 2 weeks before the attack on Pearl Harbor, which was December 7th. And then
it's not long, is it?
Right. Yeah. And he was, there was a lot of problems there in terms of, uncrating the planes and, getting his men in order, getting all these, things in ship shape. And it was a battle that was lost really before it even began. And unfortunately, he had to be a part of that.
How did he perform in the air? Did he match expectations?
Yes, I think he matched his own expectations. I know he was a big critic of himself, and I think he was one of those guys who he couldn't wait to get in the air. He couldn't wait to be involved in air-to-air combat and sort of test his own mettle. There were atmospheric conditions with the radios and the certain flights, and by the time they rendezvoused over Clark Field, which was the big air base outside of Manila, I mean, it was already a smoking ruins. The Japanese leveled it by the time he finally got there, so he was, again, behind the eight ball before he even started. And he was, trying to play catch up. But he really did a great job in terms of, rallying his men and getting his unit and keeping it in as an attacked fighting unit and in, as best shape he possibly could. And, when he did get into the air, he was remarkable. He definitely demonstrated that his skill with the P-40 was almost unmatched in the Philippines. He shot up several enemy planes. And unfortunately, that was a part of the war where we didn't have gun cameras yet installed. And a lot of records had to be destroyed prior to, the fall of Bataan. So he was never officially classified as an ace. He met that goal. He reportedly shot down 6 planes and had a big convoy Japanese convoy of trucks that he shot up. And this was, in the early part of the war, December, January 41, 42, right, as the retreat into the Bataan Peninsula was taking place. So he acquitted himself well, and what little time he had and what little opportunities he had to be actually flying a plane.
When he gets to the on the Bataan Peninsula, they become infantry. Presumably, they've had some infantry training. And no planes.
Angus, you use that word presumably, and you know, one would think so. And I think that, you know, you look at today's military, you know, and I don't know how exactly things have, you know, in other countries, but for the most part in the American military system, you know, everybody, I know the Marines are different. In the Marines, everybody is a marksman, they call it. Everybody is a rifleman. So it doesn't matter what you do, what your MOS is, how you want to go about your military career, you're going to learn how to shoot a gun one way or the other before you get out of basic training. Back then, that wasn't the case. you know, if you were going to be an airplane mechanic, you never picked up a pistol. You never qualified at the range. You picked up a wrench, and that's what you that's what you did. So a lot of these guys, once we were running out of planes and there were obviously no reinforcements coming in from the Japanese blockade, there was just this, you know, shortage of planes, but you had this surplus of pilots, and we needed some infantry. So they threw these guys out into the jungle. Again, fortunately, fate intervenes. Ed Dyess was, like I said, a guy who grew up on the frontier. He knew his way around firearms, knew how to shoot. So he kind of had to transmit his knowledge of all these things, you know, to his men, both enlisted men and pilots. And again, deserves the ultimate credit for this. He ended up creating this infantry fighting unit that was, you know, almost on par with some of the other professional fighters in the Philippines, such as the Philippine Scouts and some of the other regular army units. You know, the job he did in terms of training his men and keeping casualties down and accomplishing the goals and, you know, the missions he was assigned, is it's remarkable when you think about it.
Well, one of them is an amphibious assault, which one would have thought you would give to more seasoned, experienced troops rather than pilots converted or aircrew converted to infantry. An amphibious assault, we'd have thought, would be a rather specialized task.
And to be honest, I have never come up with or found a good answer for that question. Why weren't some more experienced or better trained units given this job or assigned this task? Especially when you think about it, there was a regiment of United States Marines on Corregidor, who presumably, to use that word again, would have been maybe better suited for this type of operation. But for whatever reason, the Marines, they were left to guard duty on the Corregidor's beaches. You know, the high command, the U.S. Army, it's called USAFI, United States Armed Forces, Far East in the Philippines. They called for Dyess. He had demonstrated his skill in the jungle during the Battle of the Points. He went around just grabbing, recruiting guys in his own outfit who he knew were crack shots, and he knew that they wouldn't fold under the pressure, and he was confident that they could get the job done. I think a little bit of this might have been not quite ego, but I think he was sort of tired of sitting around. I think one of his best lines was he was out in the jungle one time, and one of his men behind him heard him, the closest thing to a complaint he ever uttered. He was always a positive, you know, glass half full, optimistic guy. And, you know, it was one of those days where he was out swatting mosquitoes, and it was, you know, probably, you know, triple digit temperatures in the jungle, sweltering conditions. And Dyess said something in effect. He said, man, this is awful. I'd rather be home in Texas staring at the southbound end of a northbound mule. You know, his particular sense of humor is, you know, his folksy frontier West Texas sense of humor. And, you know, and it cracked this man up. It, you know, alleviated the situation and things. Truth be told, he embraced this. He loved the opportunity to take the fight to the enemy. Keep in mind, the guys on Bataan, you know, they've been absorbing it for how long? You know, they've been taking these hits. You know, they're being bombed every day, strafed every day. You know, they're on the receiving end, and you know, this is an opportunity for him to sort of be on the giving end of a battle. And it was, you know, it had been a long, hard battle, you know, for the Battle of Points. And this was a way to close it out. And he probably said, I'll land on a beach. That's no problem. I'll jump out of a boat. You know, and so he pulled these guys together, you know, guys in his unit that he had confidence with, and just went at it.
And it's successful. He gets a Distinguished Service Cross for that.
You know, there were 20 men who participated in this operation, America's first amphibious landing of the war. And there was one left. And I went to visit him. I was in Seattle, Washington, spent the afternoon with him. And he, you know, he told me the whole story of these boats are being dragged by, you know, motorized craft. These boats are basically whale boats, kind of rowboats you'd see, you know, on the side of a ship. They dragged them in with the tide, cut the ropes, and they float in there. Meanwhile, the Japanese are bombing. There's shrapnel flying up from the sand. These guys, they're sitting in the boat. They froze. They were scared to death. Dyess, meanwhile, was already out charging through the water. He's the first guy in the beachhead. You know, he's there. He's firing a Lewis gun, which I don't know if you're familiar with. They were, you know, mounted on planes and things, you know, way back. You know, big barrel, and they have you know, circular magazine that, you know, sits on top. And you have to hold the thing with an asbestos glove because the barrel gets so hot, you know, when you're firing it. Dyess is on the beach there holding, you know, this, you know, he's firing his Lewis gun, you know, at these Japanese positions. And he thinks he has these 10 guys behind him. He turns around. There's nobody there. They're in the boat scared as hell. And so he has to turn around, you know, come on. I thought we were men, you know. So he shames them into joining him. So they, you know, they sort of rushed onto the beach, and in a matter of hours, you know, the mission was over. But you know what the funny thing is that that wasn't the big deal for him. The big deal for him was being reassigned to Bataan Field, where he was put in charge of all the air operations, essentially, on Bataan.
And I didn't even know they had any planes left on. I thought they're all gone. So, I mean, it was real lucky there.
Yeah, you know, there were a few left. And, you know, we had a lot of guys over there who were, you know, again, if you think about it, you know, during the Great Depression, this was a generation of folks who knew how to make do and, you know, make a lot out of nothing. And I think that sort of that can-do attitude was one of the reasons that enabled, you know, the American and Filipino forces on Bataan to survive so long. If you really look at it, you know, the Japanese had a very strict timetable. They needed to conquer the Philippines within a certain amount of time. Bataan didn't surrender for 99 days. You know, they kept the Japanese occupied for so long, and it was because these guys, I mean, there was obviously a pride factor in it that they didn't want to give up, but yet they made do. So they ended up repairing planes and trying to fashion spare parts out of different things. One of the guys who Dyess ended up escaping with was a master mechanic from Wyoming by the name of Leo Bolin's lieutenant. And again, one of those guys who could sort of, you know, make something out of nothing. And he basically built a plane that they called the P-40 something, because it was built from spare parts of wrecks and planes that had been shot down or, you know, ground looped on these airfields. They had mostly P-40Bs, the P-40Es, E models in the Philippines at this time. But it was such a hodgepodge of parts, they couldn't really give it, you know, an official designation or tail number or anything. So they just called it the P-40 something. They were able to accomplish, you know, the impossible somehow, some way.
Is that when he straps the 500-pound bomb underneath and uses it as a dive bomber?
That was his next, probably on, you know, like I said, his list of heroic accomplishments, the raid on Subic Bay. When Dyess found out, again, a fateful occurrence, that the Japanese, you know, they had a big shipping operation there in Subic Bay, which was north of Bataan near Olongapo. It was a great anchorage, and they were, you know, marshaling resources there to make their final push on Bataan to, you know, to get the American forces to surrender. That's when Dyess got this idea that, you know, even though the P-40 wasn't designed as a dive bomber, you know, some of the guys like Bolin's that I just mentioned, you know, they were open to experimentation. So they, you know, started figuring out, well, maybe we can put a 500-pound general purpose bomb on this thing and, you know, it won't head right into the ocean. So they worked up a rig for it. They got some springs off of some belly tanks, drop tanks. And I think there was actually some Japanese parts that they from a zero that they hooked up on here, and Dyess and a few other guys, they rotated, and you know, they made a few sorties. Most of them took 30-pound fragmentation bombs, and you know, they strafed the docks and things like that. But Dyess, he went all in. He went after a big Japanese cruiser, a couple other small boats, and he was trying to get the big hit. He was going for the home run with the big bombs. There was another, you know, just another part of his lore was, you know, his idea or his attitude that he wasn't just going to sit back and be a part of a losing battle. He was going to inflict as much damage and you know, any opportunity that he had to be on the giving side as opposed to the receiving side, he was going to take it.
And presumably all the pilots were evacuated out. You know, they have some planes. Presumably pilots are you know, a high value commodity. Why is he not you know, evacuated out from Bataan before it falls?
Well, that was certainly through no fault of his commanding officers, and those are folks on Bataan as well as you know, in Australia. You know, there was a big push at this time, especially a man of his skill and talent as an organizational leader, but one of the you know, one of the senior officers says, you know, that well-trained American combat pilots, they can't help their country behind barbed wire. They tried to, you know, get Dyess to come along to their point of view on this. But again, Dyess, he was different. He was, I'm not saying that the guys who did follow orders to evacuate, you know, to get off Bataan before the end came, that they were cowards or, you know, I'm not bringing that up in any sense, you know, the word, but I think Dyess felt he had a responsibility to his men, to his unit. He was married, but he kind of felt as though that these guys, even though they were only maybe in some cases a year or two younger than them, some were even older, he felt that they were sort of like younger brothers. They were family members, and he felt a real responsibility, you know, as a leader and kind of as their, you know, surrogate brother, you know, older brother, you know, the way they looked up at him, that he couldn't leave them behind to whatever fate that they were going to experience. I think it might have been a little bit of ego, but he thought that he needed to be there to sort of lead them into whatever the next step was. And unfortunately, that next step was the Bataan Death March. But I don't think he didn't see that coming, and really nobody did. But I think it was more of a thing. It was just sort of his value system, his morals, the way he was raised. And
so in that respect, how did he get on with the Bataan Death March? Because in some respects, that's, you know, you put your head too far over the parapet to help people, and you know, could well suffer the consequences.
Yes, that was definitely the case. I think in that, you know, he probably awoke to that. You know, the surrender was on April 9th. It remains the largest surrender in the annals of United States military history, approximately 75,000 American Filipino troops. And, you know, and he was one of them. And I think he woke up the next day, April 10th, you know, being prodded into line by a Japanese bayonet, thinking, boy, I made the wrong decision this time. You know, he ended up, you know, he wanted to be there with his men. He wanted to be able to sort of, you know, be there for them, be there to lead them into captivity and sort of keep them, you know, keep them there. I think he honestly felt as though Uncle Sam put these men into his charge and, you know, his responsibility. And, you know, he led them from the States to the Philippines, and he was going to try to bring as many of them home as he possibly could. And probably felt the best way to do that was by being both literally and figuratively at the head of the column.
Yeah, yeah. And before he leaves Camp O'Donnell, did he go from Camp O'Donnell? I can't remember it's where my memory is filming. How long is he there before they move to Mindanao?
Well, he's at Camp O'Donnell first, and the only troops who were held in Camp O'Donnell were troops from Bataan. And then they were joined about 3 or 4 months later by the troops who had surrendered on Corregidor at Cabanatuan. And that in Cabanatuan was more of a central holding area for all the prisoners in the Philippines. At a certain point, though, Cabanatuan got overcrowded, obviously, when you have all these, you know, tens of thousands of prisoners. And the Japanese started sending shipments of these prisoners to different areas to help contribute to their war efforts. Some went back to the home islands. You know, others were sent to Formosa, Taiwan, other places. And then the opportunity came up to ship about 1,000 of these guys from Cabanatuan down to the Davao Penal Colony on Mindanao, which was an effort to reduce overcrowding in Cabanatuan, but also to put these American prisoners to work as slave laborers, you know, to help the Imperial Japanese war effort. And that was a big motivation to get them south.
And he volunteers to go. I mean, I'm quite surprised that they even asked for volunteers. So yeah, I would have thought they'd just say, you 1,000, you get on a transport.
They sort of set up a list. And I think that, you know, most guys, you know, they, given the opportunity, you really didn't know, you know, where you were going or what was in store for you. But I think the general mindset that Dyess had and all the other guys that went with him, whereas, you know, any place has to be better than this. But that was another thing that, you know, that anything that went with in terms of the Japanese plan, it became, again, a recurring theme. In some cases, it was a joke, is that they didn't think the Japanese can make something worse. But yes, they always did. You know, anything that looked inviting or looked positive turned out to have a catch to it. And the catch was they would get on this crowded freighter in Manila, take this long journey to Mindanao. And although the camp at the Davao Penal Colony was a little bit better built, they had access to, you know, to clean water and, you know, a little bit better food, the Japanese expected them to work, and they were going to work them to death. This was basically a prison plantation built into the middle of this vast swamp that the Philippine government had built 10 years prior to the start of World War II. And it was kind of built along the lines of Alcatraz in San Francisco, the federal prison, or, you know, Devil's Island, the French, you know, penal colony. Nobody had ever escaped from it. It was where all the worst of the worst criminals in the Philippine Commonwealth were sent prior to the war. And the Japanese just figured, well, this is a great place to dump 2,000 Americans and work them to death. No one's going to know they're there. They can grow crops for the Imperial Army. That was basically the plan. But once they got there, and Dyess, again, if he sees a little crack, he'll try to find a way out. And that's exactly what he did.
So when we say escape proof, this is not escape proof as in high walls and you know, miles of barbed wire. This is escape proof due to the absolute hostile terrain of which this place is surrounded by.
Exactly. It was remote. It was basically about 30 miles outside of Davao City, which was the bigger metropolitan area on Mindanao, out in the middle of this jungle. In this, it was built purposely into this swamp in order to prevent, you know, any of these murderers and rapists and what have you from trying to escape prior to the war. There was a small stockade where the prisoners were kept, and that was triple fence, barbed wire, guard towers, armed guards, that sort of thing. Outside of that stockade, when these prisoners were let loose to go to their daily chores, to their certain parts of the field, be it rice paddies or, you know, chicken farm, coffee farm, different vegetables they were growing, that was all basically wide open. But the fence, in quotation marks, was really the jungle. It was the swamp. And I think the Japanese commandant, he saw the records. No Filipino convict had ever successfully gotten out of there. And there was also, you know, the matter of impediments to escape was, you know, there were some Philippine crocodiles are some of the largest in the world, some of the nastiest and meanest. And these things would grow to 10 to 15 feet in length. The insects were horrible. There were no good maps. Nobody really knew where the thing started, where it ended. There were no paths. And to top it all off, there were rumors that the portions of the swamp were inhabited by tribes of headhunters. So it was a deterrent to want to stay and just eat your single bowl of rice every day and just, you know, hope you were going to make it out.
Well, how fit were they to even attempt an escape? Because they've been on, I say, starvation rations. They've been underfed for a long time.
They were in pretty bad shape when they came down from Luzon, from Cabanatuan. Sure enough, these guys went around making preparations to an escape, and they figured that, you know, a big part of that was they couldn't even attempt such an outlandish venture without building up their strength. And so through the process of stealing food that they were growing, you know, ostensibly for the Japanese army, plus Red Cross supplies came in at a very, very opportune time. And the local Filipinos, some who, you know, worked in the facility, the camp there, were very sympathetic and very helpful, and they would smuggle food and medicine and clothing and things of that nature. So they were able to sort of stockpile some goods and supplies, as well as build up their health, you know, for this escape, for this arduous journey that they knew was ahead of them.
What is the escape plan? How do you escape from an escape-proof prison?
They figured out a way, and their way was, like I said, befriending some of these sympathetic Filipinos who would, one of them was an assistant superintendent of the camp. His name was Juan Asinas, who had been there for a few years, and he provided some early survey maps of the vicinity. And then they ended up recruiting two Filipino convicts who were in the penal colony for murder to go with him and to sort of prove his guides. Again, it wasn't a perfect plan. There was no such thing as a perfect plan, but it was a plan. And they figured if they could act on it and put it together, they might have a 10% chance of success and escape was better than 100% chance of death in the prison camp.
And they just walked through the gate. It's as simple as that.
You know, they did just walk right out. Obviously, there was some scheming and some subterfuge. They had the Japanese convinced that they were going out to work on a Sunday, which should have alerted the Japanese right away, that, you know, because Americans weren't volunteering for work on a day off ever. I don't think there's ever been a American military personnel who doesn't know that, you know, you don't volunteer for anything. You don't volunteer for any job. But they were, you know, said they were going to go out and build a rain shelter. Sunday was a day where the Japanese didn't have many patrols or guards out. Again, you know, I think it was a hubris factored into it in terms of the Japanese commandant and the guard details. This place was escape proof. Nobody was going anywhere. They figured that, you know, nobody would even attempt it, given the rumors and the location and all the other obstacles that were placed in the path of these guys trying to do it. So I think there was the notion that nobody's going to try it. We're not even going to worry about it. The Americans, they used Japanese pride against them.
Well, you see all the great escape threat films from the war where they're digging tunnels and building gliders and And here they are. They just walk out the main gate and say, you know, we'll be back. Honest.
It had to be that way because, I mean, you know, they had all these planning discussions, which incidentally took place in the camp latrine because the place stunk and they knew that there wouldn't be people hanging around there to eavesdrop. You kind of went in and did your business and got out as fast as possible. So they had these conferences and these nightly discussions there, and they figured out that, well, we can't cut through the wire of the stockade. We can't jump out in the middle of the night. We can't overpower guards and take their weapons because there would be reprisals. Because they were very careful. They didn't want to jeopardize the lives of their comrades they would leave behind. They really planned this out intelligently. That's one of the things that struck me the most was this ragtag group of guys who didn't know each other from Adam, from different backgrounds and different groups, different ages, different branches of the service. The way they came together so well, and they all were on the same page, and they thought out these things so carefully. It really is impressive when you think about it as a purely military operation.
When you escape into you're on an island in the Philippines, it's occupied by the Japanese, and you're surrounded by, you know, ocean is the islands. Where are you going to go? Where do you escape to?
One of the escapees, a gentleman by the name of Bob Spielman, he was a young sergeant, the youngest member of the group. He told me, he said to escape, he said, it's a great idea. He said, but what good is it to escape and go hide under a rock somewhere? Our goal was to get back into the war. He said, the primary mission of this group was, you know, it wasn't to save their own skins. The U.S. War Department called it the greatest story of the war in the Pacific in 1944. And a lot of that was advertising and promotion and propaganda. But I think that this is probably the truly greatest escape of the wars, because these guys had a true mission. They weren't tunneling out to go secure their own freedom, or, you know, they wanted to rejoin forces. They had a real mission that they wanted to break the news to the world of the Bataan Death March, of what the Japanese were doing to these prisoners in the Philippines and the conditions in these camps, and to sort of shock the world, break the news, and get this story out. So they had a very strong impetus for their, you know, for their mission. And I think that that was a driving force behind them. And it made them come up with sort of a second and third levels to their plans. Again, they weren't going to just break out and sit out the rest of the war. They wanted to go from point A to point B to point C. Just like you said, okay, how are we going to go about doing that? They realized that they were roughly 500 to 600 miles still distant from friendly forces in Australia. And they figured, well, we'd have to get a boat. They obviously grabbed an Annapolis graduate. Melvin McCoy was the ranking, Lieutenant Commander McCoy was a ranking member of the escape party. He was a brilliant mathematician. They figured, well, he went to the Naval Academy. He should know how to steer a boat. He ended up thinking, well, we'll get a boat. We'll, after we escape, you know, we'll make it through these jungle, you know, through the swamp. We'll meet up with some friendly guerrilla forces, which they knew that, you know, through word of mouth and through some of the friendly, sympathetic Filipinos, that there was a resistance movement forming in the Philippines to resist the Japanese occupation. So they figured, okay, if they could sort of get themselves to a certain point, they would be able to find some friendlies to help them out. And again, I think if you look at all the other places where escapes took place in World War II, you know, a lot of it depended on, or successful escapes depended on, friendly populations. If you were in occupied areas, things like that, where the civilians would help you out, you had obviously a much better chance of succeeding. And the Japanese occupation had been especially brutal, and the Filipinos were still loyal to the Americans. So they figured that they could get out, get through the swamp, and then secure some help from some Filipinos, and then get a boat, get to Australia, and, you know, reach friendly forces. So it was all sort of you had to reach the next level every time you move forward. So again, the plan was really, really well thought out from an operational perspective. It wasn't just one of those deals where we're just going to get outside the barbed wire and sort of whatever happens, happen.
Now, what amazed me is, so it's all right to sit in a camp and think, well, we'll meet up with some guerrillas. A, you've got to find guerrillas, and guerrillas by their very nature are difficult to find. So that's one thing that's you're trying to find something that's not there to be, that's not going out of its way to be found. But when they do find them, they're led by a U.S. Army, well, Wendell Fertig. What is his rank? A remarkable man.
And remarkable man is, that's a good way of putting it. He was, again, one of those great characters he's a friendly American officer, but yet he's an antagonist, you know, in a lot of ways. So these guys, they get out without divulging all the great details of this escape story. And they meet up with friendly Filipino forces who introduce them to Wendell Fertig, who was the leader of this burgeoning resistance movement on Mindanao. But it turns out this guy is basically running his own little fiefdom. He's kind of made himself a warlord of sorts. He's promoted himself to general because he figures, well, the Filipinos worship MacArthur and he's a general. I'll be a general too. And they'll basically think that I'm the guy to be listened to. I'm the one, as they call it in the Philippines. And that way he could consolidate power over the other sort of competing factions and guerrilla organizations, which on his part was a pretty shrewd move. But as it turned out for the heroes here that we're talking about, you know, these guys, again, had a larger mission. Wendell Fertig, again, promotes himself to general. He's a former miner, engineering officer. And he sees these 10 Americans coming out, eight of whom are officers. He sees it as sort of an influx of manpower that he greatly needs. And these are commissioned officers that he wants to induct into his private army. That creates a problem because a lot of these guys, all of these guys, they had their own mission. They weren't joining Wendell Fertig's private war.
I did make me chuckle that, you know, I've just realized I noted him down as Lieutenant Colonel. I read that he promoted himself to Brigadier General. And I think he didn't even tell the Americans that he'd done so. And it caused some umbrage. They had to kind of relent because otherwise his position became untenable within the Filipinos. So he really did self-promote himself.
Right.
Fantastic.
And that is, I mean, you do bring up a good point there. I mean, he had a fine line to balance between being recognized and authorized as the leader here, the connection between the American high command in Australia and General MacArthur, plus he was there on the ground being chased by the Japanese and had to answer to these Filipinos who wanted him to strike back at the Japanese. He is fighting a difficult war in that regard. And it was funny because when I first learned about him and I was researching and getting ready to write the book, he just struck me as this, you know, almost a Colonel Kurtz type character. You think about how Conrad wrote it, and then you think of the movie, and you know, he's almost this mysterious, shadowy figure who's kind of running things behind the scenes. And
he really does hinder them trying to get off, doesn't he? He really isn't helpful in organizing their escape from the island.
Again, I think that he welcomed their arrival as, you know, in some regards, you know, he didn't look kindly upon it because these guys could see through his little act, especially the two guys in the escape party who were graduates of West Point and Annapolis. They weren't keen to taking orders from this guy who was promoting himself and being a part of this motley organization. But yet he also realized that they did have a larger mission, and they generally impressed it upon him as they weren't going to play by his rules. They were going to move forward with or without his assistance. They ended up sort of getting the message across to him.
I was surprised that the Americans went to the bother of sending a submarine. It seems like a real high value escape for a handful of escaped prisoners of war to send in a submarine to get them off. I mean, am I being unfair?
Yeah, that's an interesting observation. And, you know, when you look at it, it may seem like a big risk, especially at that time. You know, you're talking about summer 1943. The war in the Pacific is still, it's reached a point, obviously, a year after Midway, where the Allies, the United States, we're not losing the war anymore. We're not exactly winning it either. These waters around Mindanao, they're still infested with the Imperial Navy vessels. Not an easy deal. But then again, given the logistics and the distances involved, there's no such thing as, you know, sending in planes for an easy extraction. And the submarine was what worked best. Plus, once the news got out and MacArthur's headquarters was alerted to the fact that, hey, somebody had actually broken out of a Japanese prison camp. This didn't happen every day. As a matter of fact, it didn't happen anywhere else. There was no large scale, there was no bigger escape in the entire Pacific War than what these guys pulled off. When MacArthur realized that, hey, there was someone there who had intelligence about Japanese forces, they wanted to know what happened after the fall of Bataan, what happened during Corregidor's last days. Again, you know, Japanese troop dispersals, supply points, all those things. Plus, this news of the atrocities, you know, what was going on. Japan had kind of pulled a bamboo curtain across their conquered territories in the Pacific. These guys were almost like survivors from the Alamo or from Custer's Last Stand. And, you know, they showed up. This was a big deal. So, yeah, to send a submarine, even though you don't have a lot of resources in the area, I think MacArthur realized that this was, we got to get these guys out. They pulled off 90% of their mission. Let's get them home. You know, I mean, let's help them out the last leg of their journey.
They're taken to Australia, then the US. Does he get any time in Australia? I mean, what kind of state are they in by the time they get to Australia? There's a picture of him with MacArthur, isn't there, is it July 43? And I was quite surprised how, well, certainly Ed Dyess doesn't look too bad. The other guys look somewhat more emaciated than him, but he didn't look fighting fit, but I was quite surprised how fully fleshed he looked. So, but I wasn't quite sure when that picture was taken, how long he'd been out, you know, on the run, as it were, had time to take some food in.
That photo was taken July 30th, 1943, in General MacArthur's office, his headquarters in Brisbane. It was taken on the occasion. They were each personally presented by General MacArthur with the Distinguished Service Cross.
And this is Ed Dyess's third, is that right? Third, yes. Distinguished, yeah. Service.
So, he was already heavily decorated by this point. And I think when you talk about some of the guys, their condition, Lieutenant Commander McCoy and Major Melnick, along with Dyess, were the first three to be evacuated via submarine, you know, from Mindanao. And they were about 10 years older than him. So I figured they probably didn't recover as fast as he did. And he had a healthy appetite as well. And I think they had a good 3 weeks to a month in Australia. And they were, I'm pretty sure that they weren't starving for attention or food in that regard. So they wanted to be fattened up as much as possible. And I think, too, that, you know, in order to send these guys back home, if they showed up looking like prisoners of war, it would be a little bit more alarming to the public and everything. So there was probably a PR job that was done as well in terms of getting them to look photogenic.
This is really the big controversial part of the story. You know, how much were the public, because Roosevelt stamps on the story, but how much were the public aware of these prisoners of war escaping, or was that coming back to the US, or was that completely crushed? I mean, how much of the story was gagged? Because Roosevelt gags anybody telling anything. Well,
right, though, he basically muzzled these guys from the get go. If you read MacArthur's memoirs, Reminiscences, he mentions this meeting specifically in his book. He talks about his whole 50-year military career. He talks about meeting these three guys, Dyess, McCoy, and Melnick, and learning from them about the death march and the atrocities and how much it bothered him and angered him. And he mentioned that he was so moved by their story when he met them that he directed the story to be published by his public affairs officers, but Washington and Roosevelt immediately quashed it because they realized that this story, it would go against the whole Europe First strategic policy. And I think there was a little bit there with MacArthur as well. He wanted to use this to his advantage. His goal was, I shall return. He was going to return to the Philippines, and he figured an enraged American populace would want to take revenge on Japan, which would help him get more men, material, and supplies that might be earmarked for Europe to accomplish his mission. So I think that was a big part of it, too. But once these guys got home, it was a whirlwind tour. You know, they were shuttled from all these debriefings with high-ranking officials and top brass. And the more that folks in Washington heard this story, the more they realized that this was a powder keg. And if a fuse was allowed to be lit to it, it could blow up in everybody's faces.
And how did the Dyess and the other men feel about not being able to tell their story?
It was excruciating. These guys, I mean, like I said, they escaped with this primary mission to break this news, and then they couldn't do it. It was almost as if they were prisoners once more when they reached the United States. And especially in Dyess's case, he was sequestered in a remote military hospital in the mountains of West Virginia. That way he wasn't around D.C. or a big city where media could get at him. And the same happened with the rest of these guys. One by one, they returned to the States, and they were basically muzzled and put on lockdown, threatened with loss of their careers, court martials. You know, the government wanted this story kept quiet. It really bothered them because they felt as though they couldn't succeed in their mission. They also felt like they were letting the guys down who were left behind, who they escaped to they hoped that the revelations, and by breaking the news to the world, would maybe alleviate the conditions, maybe would shame the Japanese into providing better care for these prisoners of war in their charge. And now the whole thing was being kept secret. So it was almost as if the United States government was doing Japan's job for them. They were keeping the lid down on the story. And it really bothered these guys. And you think about it in terms of the mental torture of not being allowed to speak and get it off their chests. You know, these guys, I mean, they participated in and witnessed in, you know, one of the most horrific war crimes in history, the Bataan Death March, and these conditions in the prison camps, starvation, mistreatment, torture, malnutrition, everything you think about, things that they saw, they all experienced post-traumatic stress disorder to certain levels. So again, they were almost like prisoners of their own government, and they had to deal with this anguish of, you know, having this great story that they couldn't tell, and they couldn't help their buddies left behind. So I think they felt like they were, you know, not failures, but they had failed in their mission, and they were letting down the guys they left behind, and especially all the family members. I mean, when these guys got back, they were muzzled, and the government, you know, put the clamps on them. But as things do, you know, leaks happen, and, you know, news breaks, word gets out that some guys had escaped from a Japanese prison camp, and they were in the United States. The news sort of builds up, and next thing you know, you have people, next of kin, relatives calling, writing letters. Hey, did you see, you know, my brother John or my uncle? He was on Bataan. We got his last letter in March 1942. Did you see him in the prison camp? Is he still alive? And so they're inundated with these inquiries and all these people that want to know what happened to their loved ones, and they can't say a word. And in a lot of cases, they know that, hey, John died in Cabanatuan, or last time I saw Ed, yeah, he was still okay. He was in Davao, you know, but they couldn't share any of this information. It really killed them, you know, mentally, that they couldn't help these guys.
It's the Chicago Herald Tribune that eventually manages to get a journalist into hospital with Ed Dyess, isn't it? Was he allowed to? I presume he wasn't allowed to speak to journalists. That, you know, how does a civilian get into the military hospital?
Again, one of those fateful occurrences. Ed Dyess's wife, her name was Marijan Stevick, and she was from Illinois, and her family owned newspapers and radio stations. Obviously, the family was very well-to-do. She was a socialite and had a lot of famous contacts, you know, names, family, friends. Sort of realized that what her husband was telling her was bigger than what her family newspaper in Champaign, Illinois could cover successfully, and put him in contact basically with the Chicago Tribune. As it turned out, the Tribune, it had the largest audience or, you know, readership in the country at that time. They had not just the Tribune, but the Tribune owned about 100 associated papers in different towns, cities. So they could get the word out. But as it happened, the Tribune was owned by Colonel Robert McCormick, who was one of President Roosevelt's biggest arch rivals. For McCormick, this was a big get for him, a big goal, because it could really stick at the FDR. Bataan was kind of an open wound still, and it was just healing. And there was a certain segment of the population that felt as though our troops had been abandoned over there. When you break down all the lend-lease, you know, the agreements and, you know, amount of supplies shipped overseas and things like that, there was a resentment that these guys were sort of left to die over there, you know, and as the Japanese were overrunning the Philippines, but yet we're sending X amount of materials, bombers, jeeps, you know, rations to Britain, to Russia, the communists, for crying out loud. You know, we're supporting the war on all these other fronts, but we're letting our own men die. And I think that the administration, to a certain extent, wanted to sort of move away from, they wanted to move on from that. They didn't want to reopen a fresh wound with, again, you know, the largest surrender in American military history. And they were successfully, to that point, playing it off as sort of like a, you know, remember the Alamo, remember Pearl Harbor type thing. It was a battle like the Alamo, Custer's last stand. It was a great delaying action. These guys are heroic. Their loss enabled future victories, enabled us to win the war. But as you know, in history, you know, nobody survived the Alamo. Nobody survived Custer's last stand. But all of a sudden, you have a couple guys who show up saying, hey, I was on Bataan. You wouldn't believe what the Japanese did to our prisoners. And it's a shocking revelation. And they wanted to keep this quiet. But I think that the McCormick, he understood that this was a way to not only sort of do his duty in terms of a publisher and a media outlet, you know, to bring the news of these developments to the American public, which is the media's job, But it was also a way to stick it to President Roosevelt, you know, his big arch rival. So I think, you know, those two things sort of factored into it. But Dyess really didn't have any of those considerations. He turned down, once his story sort of got out there, you know, behind the scenes, he had Life Magazine, Collier's, a bunch of other big time publications were after him. But he didn't care about the money. He didn't care about the fame. He wanted the largest possible readership. So the Tribune, you know, enabled him to do that. So he sort of went around the seats of power, you know, in the rules to do that to a certain extent.
I was surprised that they managed to keep it under wraps until January 44, the stories eventually were, which seemed an amazing amount of time, you know, 5 months to keep the story gagged and out of the press. But how was it received when it was first run? Did it aid the war effort, or did it, you know, hinder the war effort? I mean, there was worries about how it would infuriate the Japanese and risk the death of the remaining prisoners was one excuse for not running it. But how was it received?
I'm as amazed as you are that the story was kept quiet for so long. It's probably attributable to the fact it was a different era. A lot of these guys, I mean, I know Dyess especially, when he was given an order, he did it. Especially, you know, you think nowadays, you know, with WikiLeaks and all these whistleblowers and, you know, people who are trying to advance their own agendas or maybe their own, make money for themselves or, you know, enhance their own profiles, that, you know, you'd have these 12 guys who would willingly keep quiet. It is sort of mind boggling. But I guess in the other part of that, you have to think too, is it was a different era, but, you know, there wasn't the internet. There were no cell phone cameras. I mean, there was no way you could tweet the story out. But once it did come out, and the only reason it really did come out was there was a lot of work being done behind the scenes by a lot of journalists in the Office of War Information, the Office of Censorship, who realized that, to be honest, the American public was being not misled about the way the war was being waged or the way, you know, things were progressing, but they were almost being sort of hoodwinked just as much as the German population was, or the Japanese population was. A lot of these folks felt that, you know, that we needed to learn the real truth about the enemies we were facing and about these atrocities. And this was a different war. You know, Americans have always had this notion of, you know, insulation. Wars were always something that happened over there to other people. Now this word comes back that, hey, that, you know, these guys are being tortured, beheaded, killed just like anybody else. And it was, you know, a huge shock. I think people needed to realize that this was a serious undertaking that we were on. It wasn't just a brief skirmish. I mean, this truly was a fight for freedom. They didn't think that a lot of American people were that tied into the war. People nowadays, especially, you know, younger generations, have this. You've watched the History Channel so much. You've watched the documentaries and you've read books and things. And you have this idea that, wow. Okay, the war started in September 1939, and in the Battle of Britain, they held out against Nazi Germany, and then all of a sudden, Pearl Harbor happened, and it was just the green light. It was just full speed, you know, once America got involved, and the war was won after that point, and it was just, you know, this great, unified, concerted effort where everybody was working as hard as they could every single day, and that's how we ended up winning a war. No, there was a real lull in the middle part of this war where I think that, you know, Americans had kind of lost steam a little bit. Pearl Harbor happened about 2 years before, and this thing was dragging on. You know, the invasion of Europe hadn't happened yet. Pacific, we were, you know, making very, very slow progress, talking about yards, not miles, in places like New Guinea and these little atolls that nobody's ever heard of. People were kind of, they were slacking off, to be honest. There was absenteeism in war plants. Bond sales were sluggish. So I think all these things sort of factored in. The government kind of realized after a certain point, well, as the American people, this story is going to come out sooner or later. And when it comes out, we better harness it, harness that anger and that energy and that fire in order to aid the war effort. And that's eventually what happened. You have, you know, the War Department, the Treasury Department, the White House, everybody's in concert with this. And they finally released that story January 28th, 1944. It blew the lid off of everything and completely fired up, you know, the American people on the home front. And they realized, hey, this war had to be won. We needed to get in gear and do it, and sent bond sales skyrocketing. Enlistment numbers went way up. And I think people really started to use a phrase that they use with the war bond sales, back the attack. It ended that strange mid-war complacency that this country, at least, was, you know, was settling into.
And for Ed Dyess, he requests to be sent back to the Pacific to serve, but he's refused. Why is that?
I think a part of it is he wanted some revenge on the Japanese. He had been fighting this losing battle from the seat of his pants from day one. I think he wanted to go back with a full squadron and take another crack at the Japanese and get some revenge. And all the guys who participated in the escape, they thought similarly. To be honest, a couple of the guys didn't leave when they had chances to evacuate. A couple of them stayed and fought with the guerrillas and rose through the ranks. That's one of the really interesting stories about this. The two enlisted men, the two sergeants, Paul Marshall and Bob Spielman, on the escape, they basically started their confinement, and they went from the brig on Corregidor, where they got in trouble for drinking a little bit too much, having a party before surrender, to being prisoners of the Japanese. And by the time the bombs were dropped and the war ended, they were lieutenant colonels in the army. So, you know, a lot of these guys went from literally from rags to riches. You know, they all wanted to go back. They all had a score to settle with the Japanese because of their mistreatment as POWs. And Dyess, he wanted to lead the charge, and he wanted to do it from a cockpit for once, instead of amphibious landings, fighting in the jungle. And he wanted to be back on the tip of the spear, but he wanted to do it, you know, on a P-38 Lightning, you know, the most advanced fighter that we could put it. But the government, they didn't want to risk him being captured, shot down again, or anything else that, you know, that might happen to him. But he was placated a little bit. He was going to be allowed to lead a squadron over to the European theater.
The sad part of the story is that perhaps even before the news story even breaks, Dyess is killed in December. So the story comes out in January 44. He's killed in December 43. So he's not on active service in theater at this time, is he? What happens to him?
You know, if you're thinking about a Hollywood happy ending, it doesn't happen for him. He survives, you know, all of these, amazing, fateful occurrences, you know, on this escape. He survives the death march, all this combat experience on the ground and in the air, you know, riding on submarines. You think of all the things that could go wrong, all the bullets he literally dodged. And then he ended up dying in a freak plane crash over Los Angeles. He was getting ready, like I said, to take a squadron over to Europe. But he needed to check out on the P-38. He needed to sort of rehone his pilot skills after he had been in prison camp for nearly a year. And so he was kind of in a hurry to log some hours. And we still had a problem with bad gas. And we didn't have a lot of high octane gas that was reserved for the fighting fronts. On the home front, a lot of the planes were, the maintenance schedules weren't kept up with and things like that. And he ended up, one of his engines failed, and he was flying over Burbank, and he was going to make an emergency landing on a street there. And just at the last second, again, fate intervenes in his life, for the umpteenth time. He was 20 feet off the ground, going to somehow cheat death one more time. And this bystander, innocent motorist, pulls out of an alleyway right in his landing path. Dyess pulls up. There's no way he was going to bail out of that plane, even if he could get to altitude and, he could let it crash into a residential area, kill hundreds of people. That wasn't the way he was. So he ended up, steering the plane into a crash, into a vacant lot, and ended up dying that way, killed himself, on impact.
It's terribly sad, isn't it? You go through all the other things that could have killed him out in the Philippines and the Japanese, and he could have been shot down in combat, he could have been bit, he might have survived the death march, and then to have a diner plane accident.
It makes no sense. It really does. And I know a lot of the guys that I talked to, the guys who participated in the story, when they heard the news, they couldn't believe it, because he had cheated death so many times and been through all these fantastic adventures and things, and it was... you felt as though, again, with the magical aura that surrounded him, that he was almost invincible, but, none of us is.
Wait, tell me about the medal. He's never received the Medal of Honor.
Obviously, some of the things we talked about, from the landing at Aguililla Bay on Bataan, America's first amphibious landing in the war, the raid on Subic Bay, the escape, and a few other sort of things we didn't even get to. He could have received it probably 3 or 4 times. But on almost all of these occasions, the landing on Aguililla Bay was probably the thing he deserved it for the most heroic, tide-turning victory he produced. But the commanding officer of the army unit that was in charge of, you know, these Air Corps provisional units, he was killed the same day that took place, shot in the head. And then Dyess went to took over air operations on Bataan. And again, he was sort of floating between commands there. And again, he wasn't a guy to pat himself on the back, so he really didn't care about being recommended for medals. He was, you know, more interested in getting back into a cockpit. The overall commanding officer, General Hal George, who was like a father figure to Dyess, who would have definitely recommended him for Dyess's service on Bataan for, like, again, multiple occasions. He died in April 1942 in a freak plane crash in Australia. So you have all these guys, you know, this senior officers that would be needed to provide the documentation and make the official request. They were all wiped out. After the war, Dyess, you know, again, this, all of his heroics happened in probably, you know, I call it America's greatest hour of need. The darkest days of the war is when Dyess did all the heavy lifting and did all of his, you know, his greatest accomplishments. But yet a lot of things after that point of the war got overshadowed. You know, we had, you know, the D-Day landings and, you know, the Battle of the Bulge and the flag raising on Iwo Jima and all these other newsworthy big time events. And he's sort of gotten overshadowed over the years. Plus, there's the fact that, you know, he didn't have any kids. He didn't really have anyone to carry on his story or his legacy. And I guess that's sort of where I've stepped in the last few years, is trying to educate people, you know, about him, about this great hero and, you know, and the men that he served with and escaped with, try to coalesce and tell their story. And in certain regards, you know, I'm sort of like the 13th escapee who's trying to still tell the story to the world. You know what I mean? I'm trying to break the news to the world and tell everyone what these guys did. That's my mission right now. So I'm trying to tell their story and through telling Dyess's story and through telling the escape story. And hopefully by, you know, continuing to spread this, we can get him the Medal of Honor.
Is there a precedence for them being awarded after such a long period of time?
Yes, there is. In terms of that medal, and I think it's pretty much the same with all the, you know, if you think about Victoria Cross, Iron Cross, Hero of the Soviet Union, you know, you have to have some type of background and, you know, heroic event, you know, where you, you know, have gone above and beyond the call of duty to do that. And I'm pretty sure these standards are, you know, are universal. In America, during World War II, I think it was a case where, yeah, you know, guys did these extraordinary heroic events, but they, you know, they were tied into larger circumstances. General MacArthur, for example, was given the Medal of Honor after his departure from the Philippines. And that's always been a controversial decision by the government. A lot of that was propaganda to sort of lessen the hit that we were taking, the Allies were taking, from MacArthur being called a coward or a runout from the Philippines. But if you look at his official commendation, is it was for the heroic defense of the Philippines. It wasn't for, you know, dodging a bullet or jumping on a grenade. It was for his overall command of the defense of the Philippines during that early part of the war. And there were other individuals who received similar things. General Wainwright, who was MacArthur's successor. And then there were other individuals who, most recently, there was a Korean War chaplain, Catholic chaplain from Kansas. He received it. You know, he had a few brave moments, individual moments, just like Dyess did. But his candidacy was reinvestigated, and he was given it for the sort of a sum term of his stay as a prisoner of war, the way he ministered to fellow prisoners in the prison camp. He was eventually killed by the North Koreans. So it was more of an overall type sum of all his heroic events plus his service and his, you know, time as a prisoner of war. So there is precedence there in terms of, and this, I think it was Father Capon was his name. This just happened about 3 or 4 years ago. So there is a way to sort of go about doing this. And that's the process that, you know, that we're involved in right now and, you know, in trying to do this. But again, it's a tough situation because, you know, some of the things that sort of prevented Dyess from the recognition back then, 75 years ago, or they're obstacles to us now because, you know, these materials don't exist. They were burned, destroyed, you know, before we surrendered in the Philippines.
Yeah. And the eyewitnesses are dropping like flies.
Exactly. And, you know, and the people there who were needed for firsthand accounts, witness statements, they died in combat. They died as prisoners of war. You know, I mean, we have documentation, thankfully. You know, I mean, this man's name was on the front page of every newspaper in the country, you know, in the early part of 1944. So that's a big help. But it, again, it's, you know, it's sort of, you're reintroducing him to to a public, to a government that hasn't heard about this guy in 75 years.
And January 44, let's face it, a few months later, you've got D-Day, and you know the war goes into a real different gear that eclipses
exactly
this story. Where can we find out more? What's the link to the website?
If folks, you know, if your audience, for your listeners, or would like to, you know, dig a little bit more into the story and learn a little bit more, as well as support our efforts called the Mission of Honor to help secure Colonel Dyess, the Medal of Honor, please visit the official website at 4-4-43.com. And there is, we have a public petition that's going to be up for a little bit longer. We have not quite 30,000 signatures on it right now. So we're going to be preparing that with a bunch of other materials we're submitting to U.S. Department of Defense, you know, in order to get reopen the candidacy for Colonel Dyess for the Medal of Honor. Any folk out there, folks who have been moved by this story and our discussion of it, you know, I'd really appreciate your signature on the petition. I think, like I said, we have close to 30,000 people from, I think, upwards of 50 countries around the world. I know we have all 50 U.S. states and territories, and I think close to 40, 50 countries. So, you know, please add your name to this list and, you know, join the mission, as I say. And plus we have, DVDs of my documentary, which is 4-4-43, you know, the date of the famous escape, which, you know, the 75th anniversary is this year, 2018. You know, all proceeds from purchases of the DVDs go to the Mission of Honor, which, you know, helps, you know, defray costs that come with this fight. If you're interested in the story, you get to, you know, check out the documentary and help out a good cause as well. And we really appreciate it.
Absolutely. I'll put links on the website and Facebook. John, thanks for that. That was great. So just to recap, if you have your pen in hand, the website is 4-4-43.com. There is plenty of information on Dyess there with links to John's book and the documentary. So go and sign that petition. That is it for this episode. After two episodes in a row looking at the Pacific, hopefully I'll have fought my way out for the next episode. I'm Angus Wallace, and thanks for listening.